You guys have some regulatory timetables coming up. What is the update you can give us in terms of the FDA approval process in terms of January and the first quarter of next year for when these products will get to market?
Well, just a little bit of context, Gavin. As a company, we have embarked upon a path of achieving a smoke-free future by switching the 1.1 billion smokers around the world to safer alternatives than continuing to smoke. And these products have one common denominator. They do not combust, they don't burn tobacco, which is the major cause of toxicants in the smoke and obviously disease related to tobacco products. One of these products, which heats tobacco, does not burn it, is now in front of the FDA for approval. And there are two stages in the approval process. The one in what we call technically the PMTA, which is essentially to allow for commercializing the product in the US market without any health communication to consumers. And the other is what we call the MRTPA, which is a modified risk order, if the agency obviously approves it, where you communicate, you have the potential to communicate to smokers in the US that this product, compared to cigarettes, is potentially less harmful. And the process is ongoing. The next step in the process is a hearing by the Tobacco Product Scientific and Advisory Committee, which is by the end of January. And then and this process will continue for the MRTPA application. And in the course of the year, if the FDA obviously approves it, maybe we will have the product for commercialization without any claim in the US. And that's the timeline for the moment.
See, I think this is interesting because I think there's a lot of market consumer confusion in terms of the differences between e-cigarettes and the products that you're trying to launch. And the products that you have launched have been very successful, for example, in Japan. When you take a global look at this in your dealings with the Trump administration's FDA versus the different global regulatory regimes in each country, what comparison can you make, or how different has the Trump FDA been than the different regulatory structures around the world or even in Europe?
Well, first of all, I don't think the FDA has changed under different administrations as far as the statute for modified risk tobacco products or tobacco products is. We have to say that the US FDA is today the only regulatory authority in the world that has a very comprehensive statute on how to evaluate, authorize, and also the potential to survey these products once they are in the market. Other agencies around the world have are in the process of creating legislation that is related to these products. The European Union has some, but is not as detailed as the FDA, and other countries are in the process, and this is one of the objectives we have as the company, to create specific regulatory regimes that differentiate tobacco products. All tobacco products are not the same.
All tobacco products are not the same, and you guys have put a significant amount of resources into R&D, as well as into marketing. I think the folks who designed the Apple Store actually might have designed a store.
No, this is not the people that designed the Apple Store, but our stores are a bit more modern stores.
Yeah.
Sometimes people say they look like Apple stores, but there was no intention to achieve this. But the important thing here is that these products are made available under specific regimes, because I think from a consumer perspective, we need to avoid exactly confusion of what these products are. I think we need regulators that evaluate their development, manufacturing, and also the marketing once they are in the market in a way that is not misleading for consumers, and it's very clear of what these products are doing and they are not, because they are not zero-risk products, and they are addictive. And to your previous question, there are differences between the product that is from our side now in front of the FDA that is a heated tobacco product. You heat tobacco, it doesn't burn it, and of course you have taste and satisfaction out of it, and the ritual, although different from cigarettes, is as close as possible to cigarettes. And electronic cigarettes use a liquid. Mm-hmm. Clearly, there is enormous interest, I would say, from the 40 million American men and women that smoke in this country, as we've seen already by the amount of smokers that try the electronic cigarettes. And I think there is potential, if approved, by the FDA for the IQOS product. Clearly, the commercialization is going to be done by Altria.
Altria, that's what I was going to ask you. What impact is this going to have on U.S. businesses in particular as the next calendar year and the regulatory approval process continues to move forward?
Well, as I said, Altria will commercialize the product when and if, obviously, is approved by the FDA. What is in front of the FDA today is a dual assessment. First of all, the assessment of the potential of the product to reduce the individual risk for a smoker that permanently switches to the product.
The other part,
which I think is important, if you allow me, is to evaluate impact on the population. So obviously the policy priority should, for an approved product, is to maximize use. But there is also to evaluate pre-market and post-market any unintended use or unintended consequence. For example, are the prevalence, smoking prevalence trajectories change because of this product? Are more underage people using this product? Is there a gateway to cigarettes? Are smokers that have quit relapsing, and what impact is beyond the people that want to quit? Which I think it's legitimate concerns.
Legitimate concerns that you know your critics are going to raise, but you feel confident that you have a strategy and research to back up your research.
Correct. It's also a concern for us, obviously, and we take this very seriously. So what we have done, and that was also requested by the FDA, we have done pre-market evaluation of all these potential unintended uses or consequences, or we see no concern at this stage. In actual use in Japan, where the product has been now commercialized for 2 years, and we have already 3 million people that have permanently switched to IQOS, we see absolutely no red flags either. And then we have a post-market surveillance mechanism that the FDA can guide and other, obviously, people in public health. And if there is anything that's happening, we can always correct. But I think it's of primary importance to understand how you can address these consequences, but not impede the product from being made available to the 40 million smokers just because of some hypothetical problem in the future.
Busy times in Washington. The big debate, of course, is tax reform. I want to get your perspective as the top person at a major international organization. When you look at what's happening in Washington, D.C. and the tax debate, particularly about things like lowering the corporate tax rate, what do you make of all of this coming out of Washington?
Well, look, as any company, I guess, we are following the debate very closely, but I can only tell you what the exact impact on us is going to be once we have the final text, and if we have the final text.
Big F.
So, of course, it's important for us, like for any other company, but as I said, I think we can have a more informed conversation next time once we know what the text is.
I'll hold you to that. You'll have to come back and join us. Thank you very much, Mr. Kalantzopoulos. We appreciate your time, and we'll leave it there. A lot of exciting things happening.